Right now I'm caffeine free, but you know, I too would enjoy that cup of coffee or a nice strong cup of, you know, Yorkshire tea in the mornings. And I also love the coffee culture as well. You know, I go out with friends and we grab coffee all the time, and I love that. And I want people to embrace it because I think it's fantastic that there's a social movement sort of circulating around that. All I would say though is that, you know, decaffeinated coffee is actually really quite good. And I would struggle, and I'd love to do the sort of the, you know, the Coke Pepsi challenge with decaf and caffeinated, just in terms of the taste. You will probably notice that it wouldn't give you sort of the shakes or that sort of slightly anxious state, and you'd probably know the difference. But I've really become enamored with decaffeinated coffee and all of its flavors, and I love the cafe bar culture, so I'd love to embrace that. But so decaffeinated coffee is not no caffeinated coffee. So you do have to be, you know, somewhat mindful of that. And they looked, and you can sort of search around on the internet. There's some good sites that will describe exactly how much. Some brands have very little caffeine at all. Other brands, however, I was surprised to find can have up to 20% caffeine in. So you have 5 cups of those, you know, and you're well on your way to a standard cup of coffee. So you do have to be a little bit careful, but it's certainly a good way if you're thinking about trying to come off caffeine. But caffeine is a misunderstood drug. It's what we call a psychoactive stimulant. Everyone knows that caffeine can help alert you and sort of keep you awake. That's the thing that's most known. Caffeine, if you look at some data, is probably the second most traded commodity on the surface of the planet after oil, which I think says everything about our sleep-deprived state. The other thing about caffeine, however, that most people don't realize is the time that it is in your system. So most drugs have what we call a half-life, the amount of time it takes for half of that drug to be essentially excreted out your system. Caffeine has a half-life of about 6 or 7 hours, and it's a little dependent on what type of gene that you have to sort of metabolize the caffeine, but on average, it's about that. But what's interesting is that caffeine has a quarter life of about 12 hours. What this means is that if you have a cup of coffee at noon, a quarter of that caffeine is still circulating around your brain at midnight. So to put that in context, it would be the equivalent of getting into bed, and just before you turn the light out, you swig a quarter of a cup of Starbucks and you hope for a good night of sleep. It, you know, you would never do that because, you know, but that's exactly, unfortunately, what people do, you know, completely innocently. By drinking caffeine, you know, still too late in the afternoon. Some people say, look, I'm one of those people who can drink a cup of coffee in the evening, have an espresso after dinner, and I fall asleep fine and I stay asleep. Now, even if that's true, there was an alarming study that was done where they gave people just one single cup of coffee, a dose of 200 milligrams of caffeine, standard cup of coffee. And then they measured the quality of their deep sleep by tracking these big, powerful brain waves, these glorious, beautiful, deep brain waves that bathe all of our brain during deep sleep at night, and it helps also restore the body. And what they found was that just one dose of caffeine in the evening decreased the amount of deep sleep by 20%. Now, you would have to normally age by about 15 years to produce that type of a deficit in your deep sleep, or you can do it every single night by having a cup of coffee. And what's interesting is that those people will wake up the next morning. They won't remember waking up because they may not have woken up, but the quality of their deep sleep was so poor that they will still then feel unrestored and unrefreshed by their sleep. Here is the irony that now they're starting to reach for 2 cups of coffee rather than one, and so develops this dependency cycle, this sort of addiction spiral, as it were. So I think people are perhaps unaware of the true impact of caffeine, how long it sticks around within your system, and even if you feel that you're immune to that evening cup of coffee, how it will still impact your sleep, even though consciously you know nothing about it. You know, the analogy, I guess, would be a drunk driver at a bar. You know, they've had a couple of pints, maybe a few shots, and they pick up their car keys and they say to you, you know, look, I'm fine to drive home. Yeah. And you say, no, I know that you think you're fine to drive home, but trust me, you're not. You are objectively, you're impaired. It's the same way with a lack of sleep, that our subjective sense is a miserable predictor of objectively how well we're doing with a lack of sleep.